All right, up to this point, I've been talking about regression in the context of a scalar input and continuous output. Or sorry, scalar input and continuous input. So basically this x variable. But the truth of the matter is we could actually have vector inputs as well. So what might be an example of where we might want to use a vector input?
A couple of things. One, if we look at the housing example, like we said earlier, there are a bunch of features that we weren't keeping track of. So we could have added some of those.
Great. Yeah, we could include more input features and therefore combine more things together. But how would we do that? So let's say, for example, that we have two input variables that we think might be relevant for figuring out housing costs, the size, which we've been looking at already, but also, let's say, the distance to the nearest zoo. We think that that's a really important thing. People like to live close to the zoo, and so...
They're probably not too close to the zoo.
Possibly not too close to the zoo. But let's imagine that it's like size, something that actually... let's do it the other way. Let's sort of imagine that the further away from the zoo you are, the better it is. Just like the bigger the size is, the better it is. Mm-hmm. So how do we combine these two variables into one in the context of the kinds of function classes that we've been talking about?
Well, if we think about lines, we could just generalize to planes and hyperplanes.
Right. So in the case of a one-dimensional input, that one-dimensional input gets mapped to the cost. But in the case of two-dimensional inputs, like size and distance to the zoo, we have something that's more like a plane. Combining these two things together in a linear fashion to actually predict what the cost is going to be. So this notion of linear functions generalizes, this notion of polynomial functions generalizes too very, very nicely. All right, there's another kind of input that's important too that let's think about a slightly different example to help drive the idea home. So let's imagine that we're trying to predict credit score. What are some things that we might want to use as features to do that?
Do you have a job?
I do, actually.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I misunderstood. So you're asking. Oh, so you're saying one feature that could be important for predicting someone's credit score is yes or no, do they currently have a job? Right. Another thing might be.
You could ask instead how much money they actually how many assets they have. How much money do they have? Credit cards.
Great. So right. So things like what is the value of the assets that they own? Right. So this is a continuous quantity, like we've been talking about. But something like, do you have a job, yes or no, is a discrete quantity. And one of the nice things about these kinds of regression approaches that we've been talking about, like polynomial regression, is that we can actually feed in these discrete variables as well. Certainly if they're Boolean variables, like do you have a job or not, you can just think of that as being a kind of number that's just 0 or 1. No, I don't have a job. Yes, I have a job. What if it's something like, you know, how many houses do you own?
Mm.
That's pretty easy because you could just treat that as a quantity, a scalar type quantity. What about type of job?
Oh, type of job. I like that. How about hair color?
So, yeah, how would we do that? If we're trying to feed it into some kind of regression type algorithm, it needs to be a number or a vector of numbers, and they can be discrete. So how do we encode this as some kind of numerical value?
Well, we could do something ridiculous, like actually write down the RGB value, which would make it kind of continuous.
Interesting.
That seems insane, but you could do that. Or you could just enumerate them and just assign them values 1 through 6 in this case.
Right, 1 through 6. Or they could be vectors like, is it red, yes or no? Is it beige, yes or no? Is it brown, yes or no? Have it be a vector. And actually, for different kinds of discrete quantities like this, it can make a difference, right? So in particular, if we just gave them numbers, then it's kind of signaling to the algorithm that blonde is halfway between brown and black, which doesn't really make sense. We could reorder these. Actually, the RGB idea doesn't seem so bad to me.
Except, of course, right? You have an interesting question of what's the real RGB value. It implies that somehow interpolating between them makes sense.
That's right. That's right.
It also implies an order, right? It implies that the scalar order of RGB is somehow means something, that it's no different from saying red is 1 and beige is 2. So if we multiply it, for example, by a positive coefficient, then the more RGB you have, the better or the worse, right?
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Though, in fact, what I had in mind here is for RGB, it's 3 different hair colors.
I thought the G stood for green.
People don't have green hair. They have gray hair.
But I thought the G in RGB stood for green.
Yeah, it does usually, but I'm making a hair joke.
Oh, I'm sorry. Good. I'm glad you explained that. You know, Michael.
No problem.
So, I really like the Boolean vector idea.
Yeah, so I imagine that we're going to return to these issues when we start actually encoding problems as machine learning problems.
I think you're right.
But I think that's enough said about regression for the time being.
I agree.